Krishna.
My sincere thanks to Professor KJ sir, Professor Srikant sir, and dear Pranav. And thank you to the audience for making it, taking out of their precious time. So I'll be, we all are aware of panretinal photocoagulation. I'll be talking only about the practical aspects of this thing. So the standard of care of any neovascular disease is well-executed panretinal photocoagulation. It is accepted as a long-standing efficacious means, and it suppresses, it permanently suppresses the VEGF release. And other ischemic, it can be used for proliferative diabetic retinopathy and as well as in the ischemic retinal vascular disease. It's a gold standard still. This talk will be completed under these headings: the patient comfort, laser type and settings, method and strategy of delivering, and avoidance of complications. We'll be not going into the details of how it is to be done, because these are the practical tips which are more important. So the patient comfort. It is critical because a lot of time, the moment we put the lens, we start hitting the retina, the patient starts having pain, and then he would move his eyes, and kind of it becomes difficult, especially the inferior retina. So they will have some level of discomfort, but the positioning and ergonomics will really reduce the anxiety. So what you really need to do is, the height of the machine should be that the patient is sitting straight and not like this. I mean, the moment the patient curves, it will become difficult. So keep the machine at delivery at a certain height so that the patient's head and position is straight. And then your assistant could just hold the head. And this is how you can actually, before putting on the lens, you can just describe that what you are going to do, and there will be slight amount of discomfort, but then you'll stop in between if the patient has more discomfort. These are certain words which will really, really kind of reduce the anxiety of your patient. Then during the treatment, type of anesthesia is important. Most of us, we use topical anesthetic, but extremely important not to be reluctant in giving even a block when the patient is extremely anxious or in a severe pain. Say you're going to do laser in a neovascular glaucoma, a blind eye. So these are the patients where you may even have a low threshold for even injecting and doing the lasers. Then the topical anesthesia will facilitate the maintenance of the gaze if the patient is seeing, minimizes the Bell's reflex and unintentional wandering of the eyes. Some patient requires more invasive, like we discussed this thing. And then how do we deliver, whether indirect ophthalmoscopy or we give it by the slit lamp? So indirect ophthalmoscopy, the advantage what we find here is that the patient can kind of just lie down, and you can hit through the hazy media, even mild vitreous hemorrhage, some amount of corneal edema, because these are the patients where there will be minimal discomfort because you're not using any lens on the eye. The problem will be inadvertent eye movement, so you have to be extra cautious. Your hand-eye coordination should be very good before you try this out, but you can do this thing. And it gives you a wider field of view while you're doing this laser, and it can be used in a poor media, small. This is something which we have been trying, and it helps. Corneal edema patients, usually we find it very difficult to visualize. Topical glycerin actually helps. You can just, the commercially available glycerin, 20 minutes before you can put it, the media magically actually clears. And then you can go ahead and do this laser. And this is what we we can easily do. And anterior retina is very easy, especially when you can indent the retina. This is how you can always do with indirect ophthalmoscopy. It will be a slightly irregularly done laser, not a beautiful laser to look at, but you will be able to decently cover the anterior retina. Slit lamp delivery, the advantage is precision, the control, and around arcades if you are doing. Optimal spacing you can do. Micromanipulators are there in all the slit lamps now. And a closer view, so intraretinal hemorrhages and these traction retinal detachments can always be avoided. You should not hit them. Advantages, you can stabilize the eye, Bell's reflex can be prevented, photocoagulation is more comfortable, and overall, as the laser power and focus is titrated to this thing, the therapeutic effect, you can, just one point, because I was remembering the small discussion on using the Pascal laser. Remember, Pascal could be a very fast laser to do, but there is a very significant disadvantage. That is, the posterior retina is always the thicker retina. That is, it has a certain amount of thickness. You cannot use the same delivery power when you are doing a peripheral, because you will create retinal holes with Pascal lasers. So you have to be extra cautious. The posterior laser around the arcade, maybe up to the equator, whatever the settings you are using for the laser delivery, the moment you touch the anterior retina, you have to reduce the power, you have to reduce the duration. Otherwise, you will start creating retinal holes, which will be even devastating. So, so power, size, number, sessions, diabetic retinopathy study, DRS and ETDRS were instrumental in developing the clear indications. ETDRS considered around 1200 to 1600 of moderate intensity, up to 500 micron size, 1 to 1.5 disc diameter apart, divided in at least two sessions. So if your patient is very apprehensive, this is, you can always increase the sessions. You can do it in three sessions, you can do it in four sessions. This is no guideline that you have to complete it in one or two sessions. So the clinical goal is to deliver enough number of lasers to the ischemic retina so as to regress the neovascularization. And this should include a 360 degree coverage of the retina. I personally slightly favor the greater interspot distance with a larger burn size, because these burns will have some collateral effect. That is, they will increase in time. So if you give very close by, then at one point of time, two laser burns will overlap each other. And these are the places where the retinal holes post laser develop. So if you are using, say, I prefer using around 300 microns of spot size of laser. So then at that point of time, I have around in my mind that I'll have at least 1.5 disc diameter apart, 1.5 spot apart laser. In cases of sectoral ischemia, like neovascular branch vein occlusion or hemicentral vein occlusion, one may treat only the ischemic portion as defined by fluorescein angiography. So fluorescein angiography here may be helpful, because you don't want to cover the entire retina, or unnecessary laser can be avoided. You don't want to laser a well-vascularized retina. It is tricky to assign what is the standard power, but because the burn intensity clearly depends on multiple variables like media clarity, fundus pigmentation, laser type, and mode of delivery. Common wavelength, what we all use, is 532 nanometers. Longer wavelengths like 810 diode can have the advantage of better penetration through the blood or media opacity. So now we'll just discuss a small bit of it. Three settings we have in our control: the spot size, the laser power, and the laser duration. Please try and understand. Spot size. Spot size means how much each spot area will be covered. Duration. Duration means for this amount of time the retina is going to be hit by the laser. So, and the power. Power is with what force the retina is going to be hit. So now just imagine a few different scenarios. You have a small power, you give a very you have a very small spot size, you give a very high powered laser. So pressure is what, force per unit area, you are going to immediately create a retinal hole. So for these patients where you need to increase the power of the burn, try to keep a larger spot size so that the power that you are using does not create retinal complications. Duration will have an impact on how much collateral spread of laser happens. So suppose you are unable to complete the laser in a single sitting or this thing, but you want the laser to be completed. So here you can have a larger spot size and increase the duration of the laser. So it is going to be absorbed by the retina, and in due course it is going to spread over. So this is how these things work, and these are all as per your choice, wish and will, what you want to do in order to cover the retina. No, those are the practical difficulties. What I am talking is when you want to cover the retina, I mean, these settings will not have any impact on what kind of eye you are treating, whether it is pseudophakic, phakic, cataractus, or deep-seated. No, these won't make any difference. So tips and trick, the goal is to achieve the adequate blanching with medium gray spots, avoid intense white spots, because but naturally you have burned the entire retina, it doesn't. Slit lamp delivery system, size of spot could vary between 200 to 500 microns, favoring a small size spot on the posterior pole. care should be avoided to give excess energy uptake near heavily pigmented areas like old laser scars. Again, they will absorb more and you will have retinal complications. So around scars or heavily pigmented areas, keep your laser power settings at the minimum. And using a 532 nanometer laser, typical standard power, the setting could be 300 microns for about 100 milliseconds, could be 150 or 200, depending on what kind of laser you're doing. And this is dependent on what the operator laser has, how old is your machine, how much power laser delivery at source is actually happening. So these machine people, you can call and actually ask them to give you a exact data or laser delivery at source. What you are seeing may not be delivered by the machine. So sometimes we have to increase the power because machine is not delivering what you are delivering the laser that you are seeing on your screen. Indirect spots can not be precisely adjusted, but approximately 50% of retinal coverage with one spot width is an adequate this thing, which can be used, which is mostly used in ROP lasers. And adjustment of laser setting can assist in minimizing the patient discomfort. How many sessions dividing, it could be more if the patient is non-cooperative, it could be less if the patient is cooperative. And macular edema patients are the patients where you want to do it over more sittings because you don't want to aggravate. The patient will start blaming you that you have worsened my vision the moment I have started doing laser. So if there is macular edema, be patient, do it in more sittings. A week interval between the treatment is beneficial. If you are doing in more sessions, if you are doing it in two sessions, 15 days interval is what is ideally done. Single sitting PRP can also be done, especially with machines like Pascal. Pattern commence on the posterior pole extending to the equator. The ETDRS actually had shown that the maximal ischemia happens in and around the equatorial area. So this is the area you need to definitely cover. Anterior laser, nowadays because of nice lenses, we can always go anterior. But if you have covered up to equator, you have covered a decent amount of area. And ultra-wide field fluorescein angiography can delineate the area of peripheral capillary nerve perfusion. Remember, a very small peripheral single vascular occlusion because of vasculitis is going to bleed because there is no collateral which is going to form there. These are all watershed zones, whereas a large vascular occlusion on the posterior pole will develop collateral and may not bleed. So before you treat the laser, you have to realize whether this is periphery because these are watersheds. This is going to bleed and you should have a lower threshold for lasering these. Otherwise, patients will someday come back to you with a bleed. The posterior pole, even larger vessels can be left alone on a longer follow-ups. You don't have to treat them. What you have to take with a pinch of salt, the peripheral scatter treatment are less likely to induce or exacerbate the macular edema. The well-spaced are efficacious in achieving the goal. And confident laser pattern directed at patches of neovascularization should be avoided because this will bleed. And avoid the long ciliary nerves at around 3 or 9 o'clock position. It will reduce the pain of the patient, and sometimes loss of accommodation would happen if the patient will come back to you that I'm not able to see clearly after doing the lasers. These are all complications we have faced. So then you have to reassure the patient and you have to not to repeat the same mistake again. It is advantageous to treat the inferior retina first, whether single or multiple sessions. Single session, it has been our experience that patients are able to maintain a downward gaze for a longer duration at the beginning of the laser. Second, third sittings, the patient will be more uncooperative, will not see down well. So starting, you finish off the inferior laser. And for the obvious reasons, the hemorrhage will settle down inferiorly. Multiple session, a vitreous hemorrhage could develop. So the conclusion is that with high prevalence of diabetic retinopathy and other ischemic eye conditions, well-validated, tried and true PRP remains as one of the most efficacious means. Photocoagulation standards based on DRS and ETDRS protocols are now adjusted as per your desire. Overall goal is to achieve maximal preservation of the vision with minimal patient discomfort. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Manish, for a wonderful talk.